Sounds on 29th is proud to be sponsored by Watercourse Foods, Denver's homegrown vegan restaurant since 1998, serving vegan comfort food from scratch in a friendly atmosphere. Watercourse Foods' philosophy is like their food, simple and accessible. Thank you, Watercourse Foods.
Excited? Are you guys excited? Oh, that's exciting. Let me tell you what else is exciting. My parents came to visit me here in Denver, Colorado recently. Is that exciting for you as it is for me? Okay, well, that's fun. Yeah, here's a little backup info on my parents in case you guys are wondering what Doug and Nikki are up to. They're from a town that I grew up in called Columbus, Nebraska. Big fans of Columbus, Nebraska in the house. I like that. Here's the deal about Columbus. High school mascot, the Discoverers. That's not a word. That is not a word at all. But it's terrifying because the Discoverers really messed people up. Like, those were the worst people. They're both 63-year-old retired school teachers. So what do y'all think the first thing that they wanted to do when they came to Denver, Colorado was? Magic Cyclops knows. One time someone yelled, "Go hiking." It's like, yeah, that's exactly what they wanted to do. They've lived their entire lives in the flattest place in the world. Of course they want to go up to the mountains. That would be a pretty good get-rich-quick scheme, though. No, they wanted to go to the weed store, as my mom called it. Like, they were just fired up to go to the weed store. And I was like, "Do you guys want to see my apartment? Maybe see where I live?" And they're like, "No, you're stupid, and everything you do is terrible. We know you don't even have a couch. Take us to the weed store." So we go to the weed store, and my mom's like, fired up. She's passionate about it. She's asking to smell everything. She's like, "What's that? Electric Wizard? I want to smell that. What's that? Bones Brigade? I'll smell that too. What's that keychain made of? I'll smell everything in here. I don't even care." And then my dad the whole time was like standing back about like 20 paces and just doing this weird like he's just waiting for them to cancel the legal marijuana so he can bail.
Let's give it up. Famed comedian, Penn Darfield.
Thank you very much. That isn't quite right. I'm not a famed comedian exactly. Some of you were hoping to see the comedic stylings of a young Andy Jewett who's very popular with the children. He's got some Civil War stuff of legend that you're going to miss out on. I've been voluntarily answering phones here for 20 years, and they said, "Hey, Penn, you tell the best zingers of everybody in the office, it's time for you to get out in the spotlight." And I thought to myself, you know what? That sounds pretty good, so I'm going to do that. I'm going to do stand-up for the first time, so please, be kind to me. But before we do that, I want to do the right thing, and I want to thank, let's get it out of the way, let's thank station manager Hank Turtle. Everybody, thanks, Hank. Let's thank Chelsea Sauerkraut. Keep it going. Jeff Hornacek. Avery Partition. Bram Lowenstein Villalobos. Keep it going. Keep it going. Thank you to Eric Noodles. Eric, thank you. Handsome Tony Kawanga back in the room. Handsome Tony. And, of course, Betty Pumpernickel. Thank you, Betty, for all of this. And... guys, they're only giving me 5 minutes, and I've spent a little over a minute now introducing and thanking people, which is the right thing to do. But who's ready for a little bit of those jokes? All right. Well, I don't mean to be a real stinker, but you might want to chill on the applause because I'm about to come at you with some truth, okay? There's a war on Christmas, guys. There's a very real war on Christmas that's going, but it doesn't bother me much. I'm a veteran of a couple other skirmishes, including I was part of the RC Cola team for the 80s Cola Wars, which is terrific. It's about as relevant as being the Falkland Islands during Operation Desert Storm and trying to contribute. Yeah, here's a barrel of monkeys. Drop that into Baghdad. Enjoy, NATO. Do something with it. Help out. But actually, boy, that's tough, because now we've touched on something. It's going to make it hard to do comedy, because that was a pretty crazy time in my life. That was a time where I had a wife and children, and right around that time, I lost my father's love. I lost my business, and I lost my family. And sometimes everything's great, and everything's moving on, no problem. And then you meet one of your grandmother's very close friends, and you fall in love immediately, and you can't help it. And your heart doesn't have a choice. And I'll never forget, I was at the Godfather's Pizza, and I was sitting right by the restroom, and right by the door, she had massive diarrhea. The first time I ever saw her, she burst out. I caught a whiff of her and what she was about. And I didn't have a choice. That's what happened to me. I'm a person that saw my love and I went for it. You understand? I thought I would spend the rest of my life in the nude feeding that woman cherry tomatoes. And for 3 years. Thank you, Gary. Thank you for that. It wasn't this, but I thought I'd spend the rest of my life putting a little red hat on her from the Red Hat Society days. You know, I'd send her out and make her wear the hat other times. You know, and I'd spend my life putting that little red lipstick on her lips. That's what I thought I'd be doing, but you know what? I didn't, okay? She died, and I lost my father's love, okay? And I lost my family. And laugh it up! And I lost my business! Stop it! That's not funny! Okay? Sorry, Dad, I couldn't make a touchdown for you like the other kids and win a Super Bowl. Sorry I couldn't make a basketball swish and fart at the same time on the way to manhood. Sorry I couldn't slide into home plate and skin up my knees and elbows for you. Sorry it wasn't like that. Sorry I didn't want to part my hair the way you wanted me to. Sorry I didn't want to hold your hand when I walked across the street because I was trying to fill your shoes and they were loafers and they were too big. Well, you know what? That's not going to happen to my kids. Okay? And let's address it right now. Let's address it right now. Little Jerry, here's a spoiler alert. You know Uncle Penn? This guy right here? Uncle Penn's not your uncle at all. I'm your father. You understand? And when you're at home, and I come home, and you're climbing the garage, and you jump off, and you break your damn arm, you break my heart. And when I come and bring you to this studio and have you watch Bob Ross, and he says, paint like this, and then you go home, and you paint your own body, you disappoint me. I'm embarrassed. I don't want you to lose your family. I don't want you to lose your business. Little Jerry, do you understand? I'm not going to let it happen. I care about you. Well, that's been about my time. I've really enjoyed stand-up comedy so far. My name is Penn Darfield, and you can find me on the Facebook. Thank you so much.
Nice to see all of you. Thank you, Denver, for having me. I appreciate it. I appreciate it. Shout out to all the non-nativist natives who are being really nice. It's a new word I learned out there. There's been complaints about the transplants, and I'm sorry for that. I'm trying my best. I'm doing my best. I mean, my plaid shirt game is on fleek right now. I have tripled my plaid shirt count just to fit in. Thank you. I'm drinking tap water all the time, everywhere I go. I'm growing a beard. I'm trying so hard, Denver, just to be one of you. I want to be native. I'd have a Subaru right now if you'd co-sign for me. I want to be one of you all. I'm doing my best. I don't have a car, so traffic, that is not me. I didn't do the traffic. Also, I'm black and I don't gentrificate, so that wasn't me either. Poor and black, I urbanize your neighborhood. Okay. I'm doing my best. I'm trying to fit in. I got my Nuggets hat, watching Nuggets games, because the Lakers ain't doing nothing right now. I went to Boulder, tried to fit in Boulder. Yeah, Boulder. I stick out in Boulder, like a black woman in Boulder. People noticed me. I thought I was famous for a little bit. People noticed me. But I'm enjoying myself. I'm originally from South Central Los Angeles. Yeah, home of the LA riots. No justice, no peace. Hey, Ferguson, we already did that. Doesn't work. It's pretty sad. I grew up solidly working class in South Central. It's a poor area, but we were solidly working class, which means you never get anything you want. You only get what you need. I grew up in a two-bedroom, one-bathroom house with four sisters. It was, I struggled. Be sad for me. It was hard. I didn't even get a chance to sit on the toilet by myself till I was about 12. You know, it's very crowded. Scoot over. It was hard in my household. Forget about masturbating. No privacy. No privacy. It's no fun to masturbate when you're sharing a twin bed with your sister. There's no room for your elbows. Just scoop over. Get tough. It's tough, working class. I got a haircut as soon as I got to town, though. There's so many like fierce, strong women. You gotta have a nice, powerful haircut. So I went in there, they chopped it all off. But I had these long dreadlocks for a very long time. They were heavy, they were cumbersome. I had them for like 12 years or so. And I always had this fantasy about taking a topless picture, you know, like a mermaid with my hair covering my boobs. But the longer my hair grew, the lower my boobs got. And I couldn't quite catch up. So got a haircut. I got a haircut. If my hair, my hair just became this constant reminder of where my breasts used to be, and it was just sad. And I understand why they call them cups now. They measure it in cups. I didn't get it at 23, but I get it now. I understand it. Because now when I lay down, they look like two fried eggs on a nonstick skillet. Just they just move. They just don't hold form. Whatever. That's life. That's part of getting older. I'm fine getting older. I think I look pretty good for a mother of two. I'm keeping it together. Thank you. Thank you. I don't have any kids, but I take that as a compliment. As I'm just trying to keep up. I'm just trying to keep up at this point. My name's Janae Burris. Thanks so much. You guys are so nice. Appreciate you.
Hi, thanks for having me. My name is Zach Reinert. I just recently moved here from Omaha, Nebraska. Yeah, all right. Which means I just recently had to quit a job. And when I was walking out of my last office job for the final time, I kind of wanted to say screw it and just pull the fire alarm. But I thought it was best for everybody if I just let the fire take them. This is how these jokes are going to go. I went drinking last night with my roommate, not for some terrible holiday, but just because we drink a lot. And when my roommate woke up, he was just soaked like in pee. And I was like, you know, maybe you should stop drinking so much, man. That way you know when I'm peeing on you. I have a new terrible office job in Denver. And me and my boss are the only dudes that work there, and we just had like five women go on maternity leave. So my boss was like, hey, Zach, I just want you to know the only reason why you got hired is because you can't get pregnant. And I was like, whoa, I'm still going to make you wear a condom. it's not true. I was sick for a while, so I had to go doctor and get a bunch of blood work done, and the lady taking my blood was like, hey Zach, do you have any history of blood problems in your family? I was like, well, I come from a long line of Crips, so yes. It's really stupid. A lot of these are dumb. Let's see, tell you guys about the real reason why I'm here. It's for advertisement for my White House petition, trying to get signatures to rename Little Rock, Arkansas to Little Dwayne Johnson, Arkansas. He's an actor now. Yeah, is, when I was a kid, my mom always taught me never to trust anybody with two first names. That's why I don't trust guys like Jesse James or Paul Ryan or Dikembe Mutombo. These are really dumb jokes, admittedly. I was hanging out with a friend earlier today, and he looked up from his phone at me, and he was like, did you know that eventually all the stars are going to burn out and the universe will be dark forever? I was like, dude, it's only been 15 minutes. She's going to text you back. Yeah, all right. having kind of a rough week. My niece is in the hospital. She fell in a well, and I'm having a hard time picking out what card to get her. Get well soon didn't seem appropriate. I was at the gym this week, wink, wink, and there was some guy that was like, hey, man, can you spot me? And I was like, yeah, you're right there. You're super hiding, man. And, yeah, it seems like all I've been learning about myself recently is only negative things. Like, the other night, I learned that anything is a DUI checkpoint if you crash your car into it. All right, I'm Zach Reinert. Thanks for having me.
For my forces of nature. Experts say we're due for the big one. An earthquake, the seismic equivalent of thousands of years worth of waiting. But humans build empires on the San Andreas, so these warnings leave little of fear, no nil of reserve. Oceans lose their nerve when the moon says so, goes cold, it's hard to keep my cool. I woke up missing you, as though during sleep someone had placed a pillow over my airway, just obtrusive enough to shallow my intake, called my exhale a low tide, or a tsunami's deceiving retreat prior to swallowing the beach's granulated expectations. My dreams say I'm a tease, that I don't show up as often as I should or used to. And if my coming through weren't such a big to-do, then they'd be done with me altogether. I've never been in an earthquake. I'm sure the ground has countless manners in which to be rid of us judged, measured, tested for density, weight, and shape, and our topography has mirrored the immeasurable erosion of one day to one day. Say I remind you of your favorite mountain range, that you'd risk avalanche and asphyxiation to stand at the summit of my decision, this globe, this puzzle separated by water and God's whimsy. What do peaks know of the clouds that they pierce? What will you do with the rumble in your ears as I consume my pieces new? Liquefy this now into melted magma, burn tomorrow into the landscape when the edges of our continents crash. Grip, slide along the sides of each other, sending trembles through the trees of our arms and rogue waves across the misbehaving length of eyelash to eyelash. An impromptu seascape spilling across the sandy expanse of a desert's cheek. I sweep the grit from our expectations, a layer perception like sediment. Upon sampling the core, scientists find we've always been here, colored in the shade of status quo, contrasting the autumn bronze gold tones against the ice age cold hue, palest winter blue, silver sliver of earth dirt, shivering a destructive whimper, claiming space on a shrinking globe, cold shouldering oceans who've lost their nerve at the moon's cue. Experts say I'm due for a long bout of becoming new.
I'm a little choked up from the writing intro. I think I'm a little... Hey, hello, it's great to be here. I am from Austin, Texas, where everyone thinks they're weird, but they're not, because they're all from Los Angeles. but there's some old-fashioned weirdos in Austin. I saw a guy one day on the side of the road, and he was in his full bike gear, you know, like he looked like a human NASCAR. And he had his bicycle, and he had a sign, and the sign said, biking from Austin, Texas to Anchorage, Alaska, for cancer. I was like, wow, that's a crap prize. Thank you. I would stay at home. I would. I lived in Los Angeles for a while. I'm here now. When I lived in Los Angeles, there was this billboard that I could see out the window of my SAD room, and the billboard said, "Know the signs of suicide." I know the signs of suicide, you guys. It's a dead body. Can we not talk about the signs of imminent suicide? Because that seems way more proactive. I've started drinking every day and cutting my own hair. Just a little bit, every day. It's fine. You guys, I cut my hair now because I'm too old to cut myself. And you just have to grow up sometimes. You know what I mean? There's another billboard that bothered me in Los Angeles. I saw it all the time. It was a PSA and had a picture of a kid on it. And it said, "Autism is sexy." Meh. Autism is a lot of things, you guys. Autism is what makes my brother tuck his Mavericks jersey into his sweatpants. And I'm talking like the old school sweatpants with the elastic at the ankle and the little white tie in the front, but it's not really in the front. It's always a little off to the left because the front of all of his pants are a little off to the left. It's sort of like he wakes up in the morning and locks them into place, like ready for the day. Autism can be awesome, you guys, but it is not sexy at all. My parents did not realize / accept that my brother was autistic until he was 19. Oops, that's a fail. You fail. Like they didn't even do anything. Like my brother just went to a psychiatrist one day on his own, and he was like, "Life's kind of hard." And they're like, "I bet." congratulations thus far. My mother tells me that I have a whiskey voice, which is adorable, but inaccurate. I have whiskey breath. I have bulimia voice. Let's give credit where it's due, Ma. Don't feel bad for me, you guys. I don't like to, I don't throw up because I think I'm fat. I just don't like to poop. Because I'm a lady. Speaking of being a lady, I used to live in my car. I do not now. Thank you. So I put it up on Airbnb. I call it the cartel. And for 10 bucks a night, you can sleep in the back seat of my car, and at 3 a.m., my ex-boyfriend will come around and bang on the window and call you a whore. He doesn't know I've moved. I've been married and divorced twice because I have bad parents who didn't tell me things like, "Hey, don't get married when you're 20. and don't marry a dude you met at the Renaissance Festival." Don't suggest that one. My dad didn't even give me the sex talk until I was 19. Like, that's too late, bro. Like, 19's the age my brother and I got to where my parents were like, "Oh, we forgot some things." So at a gas station, my dad tries to give me the sex talk at 19. It was all awkward. He was all like, "Now you know, there's certain things you can do, still have fun, not get pregnant, right? Like the 69, that's a fun one, you can do that." Like, "No, I can't now, ever again, Dad, thanks." I'm gonna be honest with you, I don't even like the 69 position. I find it annoying. It's like someone talking to you while you're trying to read. I'm doing things, you're bothering me. All right, well, thank you for having me. Have a great evening, thank you very much.
Let's get some comedy going here with a good friend, Sam Tallent.
Keep it going, everybody, for Magic Johnson. Excuse me, Magic Cyclops. I get them confused because of the AIDS. Now, guys, yep, it's an alarming situation. Hey, I sank Molly Brown over there. They were great. You know, I was hanging out in the green room with those guys. More like I stank Molly Brown. Thank you for not doing the drum roll thing. Guys, we're here on live television, and I want to do a bit that only works on TV. So this is a character. This is an impression. This is an impression of a fellow walking into a live television taping.
Ha ha ha!
everybody. Another character bit, one of my patented character bits, everybody. I'm going to be a camp counselor, everyone. Everyone watching at home is going to be a gay child. You're going to be gay children at home. And I'm a camp counselor and a youth pastor at a camp where you've been sent because your parents are hoping that you'll be switched heterosexual through the power of Christ. And I'm going to be a camp counselor welcoming you guys to the first day of camp. But I'm going to really mess up my welcoming to all y'all. I'm going to mess up the first thing I say. Here we go. You ready, gay kids? Yeah. All right, here we go. Hey! Oh, hey, thank you so much for coming out. Damn it. Being here. I meant, that's the entire joke. If you're at home wondering, is there more? No, there's not any more. Everybody, I was given a bucket of cherries recently. I was given a wicker basket filled with cherries by my sister who has a cherry tree on her homestead. And I've eaten too many cherries, you know, brought to the point of angry, virulent diarrhea. yeah, ruining a weekend with stepdad is what I was doing. Don't put me on the swing. And yeah, bad time. And I ate too many cherries and I had a bunch of cherries left over. I was like, what am I gonna do with all these cherries? So I called up my buddy who has a rooftop. And I said, hey pal, I got all these cherries. Would it be okay if we came over there and threw a bunch of cherries at strangers from your rooftop? And he said, why did you even call? Get over here. So I went over to my pal's house and I called up all my athletic friends. So it's me and a bunch of big surly types, a couple of African-American gentlemen, and one strong-armed lesbian softball pitcher. And we were, yeah, that's right. I represent for all in this premise. And I was whipping cherries at people from a rooftop, giving veterans PTSD flashbacks. It's a real silly time, everyone. And we're whipping cherries at people. And one guy happens to take a big cherry right on the head. And he says, hey, I'm coming up there. And we say, oh, what are you, a vampire? And then he comes up there because he's got keys to the building. And have you ever seen anyone at home, if you've ever seen anyone walk into a situation where they don't know what they're walking into and they immediately realize that they're outnumbered? This is what it looks like. Here, let's walk it through. On the way out the door, he happened to say to my friends, he said, hey, are you guys, you happen to see anyone throwing plums up here? And my buddy said, cherries, poon. I can't say the swear word I usually say. Now, I'll do one more bit, guys, then we'll get back to the unsinkable Molly Brown's favorite band. Guys, this is, I have a full head of hair atop my young, hot Rosie O'Donnell head, and I have a widow's peak. So I want to show you guys what I thought a widow's peak was when I was initially told. So here we go. Here's what I thought a widow's peak was. Through the magic of television, I'm no longer up there. All right, so here we go. Widow's peak, everybody. I miss my husband. All right, everybody. I've been Nathan Lund. Thank you all so much.
I give it up for Nathan Lund. Great.
Beautiful people of Sounds of 29th Street, how are we doing today? All right. We have a little call and response in Black on Black Rhyme. When I say back talk, y'all say talk back. Back talk.
Talk back.
Back talk.
Talk back.
And I'm going to get started with, I'm going to do a verse and then go into a poem. So hopefully we can get that going. No mic stand today. Observations can't keep my tongue content. Call myself God, no, I won't repent. Balance the male and female energy inside of me. Consciousness goes beyond the gender role. Solo road, planting daisy seeds as I go. Scapegoat, workhorse, blackmail, fit the mold. Turning into an animal farm. Politics and GMOs, they want to keep your brain redirected. Always 20 seconds, out of shape even though our design is geometric. Puppet hand at the top, our plans are not symmetric. Cryptic limericks, I've been this distant. Teach the truth, media will call you resistant. Poison, I won't buy it. Vaccines, I won't try it. There's only two options, and there's war with Goliath. My destiny, I can't deny it. And now for a poem. Being caught in a lie is like being trapped in a sandstorm, crashing into a relationship made of glass. It's funny how the same things that made you who you are can be the same things to destroy you. Lie. It didn't hurt my feelings. Lie. We can be friends afterwards. The truth is 100 miles per hour wind smacking the earth in your face, a backhand from God. It will hurt. A lie is like living life in a loophole. It will loop your whole world in a whirlwind. Every time that you talk, you can feel a sandstorm of guilt rampaging in your stomach with every step that you take. Break breath and break. If you're always covering up your tracks, you leave no room to retrace. Lie. I want to pursue my major after college. Lie. I'm doing the best that I can. Oftentimes, you can be stuck between a rock and a hard place. Do you know what it's like being stuck between a mental block and a heartache? When does a sob story become a sad case? I lost place like the truth is the farthest away, running at a faster pace. The sands of time slowing you down, dunes of negativity pulling you under. Don't strike the lightning if you can't rumble the thunder. Lie. I'm not going anywhere. I'm always going to be here for you. Actually, I've never felt more at home than when I'm on the road. Lie. I don't want any kids. The truth is, I'm afraid of raising a daughter, scared that I'll lose her at toddler, or she'll forget everything that I taught her. I lied about who I lied next to, like you like doing things that make you unhappy. Why do you like being unhappy? You knew it was wrong, so write it before you left in a lie, trapped in a sandstorm. Mistaking mirages for an oasis. Ashe. Thank you.
Man, I'm excited to be here. The timing of the show couldn't have been any better for me. I got some unbelievable news today, and I get to share it with all you beautiful people and all the people at home. My wife and I actually just found out, you guys, that we are not pregnant with our first child. I know. That's how I felt when I found out, because I'm 41 years old and I've never had a kid, and I was just like, the streak continues. Yes. I know. I consider myself to be, I don't know, like the Joe DiMaggio of not getting women pregnant, everyone. It's just like, it's a strong batting average, everyone. It's weird. I'm 41 and I haven't had kids, and I'm under a lot of pressure to do it because my wife does want to start a family. And speaking of sports, I was a competitive swimmer as a child. And I'm already disappointed in the children I'm not having. It's just like they're already a disappointment to me as a competitive swimmer. It's more like they're not really swimming. I think at this point they just think they're on a leisurely river rafting trip that they're on going down the Colorado, and they're just drinking beer and enjoying the sun. And by the time they get to the end of the trip, they're like, there's actual work to do? We're out of here, buddy. We're not going to do this. Well, that sucks. It's weird being 41 and not having kids. You get weird social situations. My wife and I were at a party the other day, and we were talking to a couple we'd never met before, and they asked us, like you do, making small talk, how many kids do you guys have? And we're like, well, we don't have any children. She said, oh, you guys are dinks. And I looked around, and I was like, well, that's just racist. We're not even Chinese. I don't know why you would say that. I know, and she said, no, silly, dink means dual income, no kids. I was like, oh, thank God, you mean lucky. Is what I think you mean. She said, that's funny. And I'm kind of a bad speller, so I thought she might have meant dual income, no credit. Either way you spell it, my wife and I are that. I don't know. She said, you seem a little nervous. I'm going to give you one piece of advice. Make sure you're in decent financial situation if you're going to start a family. You don't have to be rich, just decent start. And I was like, well, If you consider still owing $40,000 for a 6-year general studies degree I got at a Playboy top 5 party college in 1998, financially stable, then let's do this, honey. Went to give her a high five. She did not give me the high five back. That was pretty embarrassing. The lady said, well, that's not funny. You should be taking this more seriously. And as a comedian, I just responded with a joke. And I was like, well, at least now that I don't have kids, I get to day drink whenever I want, right? I know. I was excited. And she said, no, Jeff. She goes, now that I have children, I day drink way more than I did before. I was like, that makes sense. I was like, I don't think my liver's going to be able to handle me having a family at this point. But I don't know. I like to call it, this is kind of a mean joke, but I like to call it, I have one saving grace in this starting a family situation I am in with my wife. My beautiful wife is of both Mexican and Native American descent, everyone. She's a very, very beautiful woman. Yeah. What that means for me, though, is at home, she wants to have a really, really big family, but she's usually way too drunk to do anything about it. I know. That's kind of mean. But don't worry, it's not a lot of drama. Whenever we find out we're not pregnant, she only sheds one single tear. So, I know. It's an old commercial, but I still love it. No, I shouldn't say those many things about my wife. I love my wife. She's very supportive of what I do. And she's 7 years younger than me, which means I'm always trying to come up ways to be cool, stay cool for her. And I came in the other day, and she was watching So You Think You Can Dance. And I was like, well, hell, I know I can dance. So I was like, I'm going to prove it to her. And I'm a child of the 80s, so I grew up watching the movie Breakin'. Do you guys remember Breakin'? Probably not. A lot of people don't. It was a classic 80s breakdancing movie. I used to watch it every week. And I came in, I was like, I'm going to show her what I can do. And I decided to show her my pop and lock skills. So I started a pop and lock. And at 41 years of age, the only thing that happened to me is I ended up popping my hip out of socket, locking my back up. I know. And then I ended up falling over the table and breaking her favorite wine glass. I was like, I think I took that movie a little too seriously, everybody. I don't know. That's what's the situation going on in my life. I did get one piece of advice from a friend the other day, though. He said, man, Jeff, he goes, 40 really must be the new 30 for you. And I was like, no, man. Not having kids at 41 is like being 25 forever.
You guys, my husband and I just celebrated a huge milestone this weekend. We celebrated our 10-year wedding anniversary. Yeah, I feel like I need a bigger applause for not ending up on an episode of Snapped, you guys. Like, I want to become famous. I don't want it to happen on the Justice Channel. But actually, for our wedding anniversary, he decided to build a koi pond in our backyard. Yes, because nothing says marital bliss like goldfish, you guys. I mean, I think I could get behind this if this was sea monkeys. I mean, have you seen the packages for sea monkeys? They drive cute little cars, they ride bikes, they have adorable little hipster outfits. I could definitely charge them rent, which means I might be able to afford to live in Denver, you guys. Yes. But when he actually started digging the hole, we told our children we were putting sharks in it. So they've been eating whatever I put down on the dinner table and doing their homework without any questions. We're calling this a win-win scenario. But I asked him, I said, why a koi pond? And he said, I need a project. And I said, you need a project? We have 5 kids and a 30-year mortgage. Why don't you grab your toolbox and start building us a future, Handy Dan? But yes, my husband and I, we have 5 children, and having a big family is fantastic. If one kid goes missing, nobody really cares. Plus, I have a search party of 4 lined up to immediately start looking for them. But when you're a big family, people feel the need to like look at you and ask questions. And some of my favorite questions that we get are they all yours? No, I'm actually hoarding children. I think I need like 15 more, and that TLC reality show is gonna come knocking on my door. Heard they have an opening, right? The last one we get is, you guys are done, right? Well, duh, obviously birth control is really important to me right now. We've actually been exploring our birth control options, and I told my husband I was considering getting an IUD, and he got really nervous that I wanted a bomb as birth control. So we went back to using my diaphragm, you know, the one associated with your lungs, like, get off of me. You guys, it's inexpensive, it's effective, it's covered by Obamacare, so it's a really good winning situation for us. I recently went on a field trip with my 7-year-old at the end of the year, and I brought a flask. You guys, it's like a super classy flask, though. It has a little mother of pearl, and I did a schnooter, and those moms were like, oh my God, she has flask. And I was like, calm down, ladies. It's not a bomb in a backpack, right? I'm riding on the bus. I'm not driving it. My son was like, yeah, mommy needs her medicine. And his teacher was like, yeah, so do I. I feel like we have to have a very important conversation about what we're teaching our children. We need to get back to teaching our children real math. No more of this Common Core stuff, real math. Like, for example, typical math question could be, you and mommy walk into a liquor store, and there is a $37 bottle of Cabernet and a jug of Carlos Rossi for $3.99. Which one's better for mommy's book club? Yeah. And then I'm going to end on this, but I feel like we have to have a conversation about text messages. Text messages should always be about something important, you guys. My girlfriends will send me a text and say, what are you doing? Oh, I don't know. I'm just responding back to your last five stupid text messages. And then everything is OMG. Oh my God. My baby just burped. Oh my God. I just ate a taco. OMG. My new puppy just took a dump in the living room the size of a Lexus. OMG. You guys, I'm saving that text message for something really spiritual, a deeply religious moment. My text message is going to be, Jesus Christ just walked across my koi pond. OMG. You guys, thank you so much.
Keep it going for Magic Cyclops, everybody. And Sounds of 29, Sounds on 29s. Keep it going for them as well. Happy to do this year. I just turned 29 this year, guys. Anybody else not die yet? Yeah? Yeah? All right. On my 29th birthday, guys, I found my first gray pubic hair. Don't worry. It's not as, like, coming of age or gentlemanly as you think. I found it in my teeth. Last day of 28 was wild, guys. Looking at you, Silver Fox. Looking at you. I get told to act my age quite a bit. Like, Corey, act your age. Like, what if we were all forced to act our age? Like, you had to act the amount of years you've been here. I know this. 69ing would not be worth the wait. Wouldn't be worth it. Wouldn't even want to do it at that point. My girlfriend did something really sexy with her mouth recently, guys. She put a birth control pill in there. Talk about a green light. Right, gentlemen? But don't worry. We went ring shopping, so we're not going to be using birth control pills for long. Specifically, we went Nuva ring shopping. Like, we just replaced that pill with that Lance Armstrong bracelet she just tucks in there, you know? It's probably going to give her cancer. She limped in here today, actually, guys. She made it. While we're on the subject of birth control, can we all just agree that if you really believe that life begins at birth, like life begins when the bun comes out of the oven, you shouldn't be allowed to eat cookie dough. Shouldn't be allowed to have it. I'm from Nebraska, and back home is my favorite billboard. We've all got one favorite billboard, right? We just think about it from time to time. This billboard's great. It said, smile, your mom's pro-life, signed God. And I was like, heaven, yeah, God, my mom is way pro-life. But for being an all-knowing being, you sure weren't paying attention in the early 80s. Because I'm three of what should have been five, Lord. Three of what should have been five.
You guys familiar with hot dogs? Yeah. Yeah, you like that loved American fare? You guys guzzle hot dogs down, don't you? Yeah. Don't you think that hot dogs would like to be called beautiful dogs, like just once? Come on, fellas, know how to treat a lady. I'm not sure if you're aware of this, but there's a goddamn war going on outside between catcallers and everybody else. And I get it, getting catcalled sucks, getting catcalled blows, you might say. But it's degrading, it's humiliating, it's just impolite. But I think that we're going about the eradication of catcalling in completely the wrong manner. instead of nobody harassing anybody else, I think that women should just start harassing men. So, in the spirit of that, I'm gonna harass some people. All right, you guys ready? Hey, Tomcat, what you doing, Tomcat? How's it going? How's it going? What you doing? Hey, buddy, what's up? Why don't you come over to my place? Because I have this can of beige paint in an undecorated guest bathroom. All right, here's the next one. Hey, Papi, what's up, Papi? I see you, I see you. What's up? What's up, gray shirt? I see you. Do these jeans make my ass look fat? Do they make my ass look fat? Your face is doing that thing that it does when you lie to me. It does make my ass look fat. I'm gonna go cry now. Are you feeling uncomfortable, sir? He said yes. Okay, here's the last one. Hey, Papi. Hey, what's up, what's up, what's up? Why don't you come sit on Mama's lap so you can listen to me cry about how thin my sister is? All right, that's it for me. I'm Meaghan Shaha.
As I love living in Denver, the greatest city in the country, if you ask me, mostly because of the weed, the legal weed, not going to lie. Right, yeah, we have it's fantastic. Like, other states are going to succumb to structure fires, and we are working on installing a nacho cheese slip and slide down the steps of our Capitol building. Right? If you don't like the weed, the beer's off the charts. We have the most craft breweries per capita, whatever that word means, right? And we're progressive with it, too. I was in a bar recently, and they were advertising for an upcoming pub crawl for cancer. That's right, a pub crawl for cancer, you guys. We're barreling through the important issues the only way we know how, a pub crawl. For cancer, once that's such a huge success, you guys are all invited to my LSD party for epilepsy awareness I'll be throwing. It's going to be in the closet of my studio apartment. We're going to lick some paper, draw some koala bears, really get to the bottom of this one, you know. Pub crawl for cancer. That's like having an ice cream social for diabetes awareness, right? Or a fight club for domestic violence. That's not something that's going to solve the problem, you guys. But other than that, I'm having a pretty good summer. I just went to my high school reunion. High school reunion used to be like a cool thing like 40, 50 years ago, because back in the day, you used to graduate high school and get like drafted into war or kidnapped by a Native American or something. Now it's very easy to live, and we have the internet, and I don't see why I have to waste a Saturday afternoon at a VFW hall when I know what my friends have had for breakfast every day for the last 6 years of their lives, right? Plus, they closed the high school that I went to, and it's just going to be at the Cracker Barrel that most of the graduating class still works at. I'm just not going. See, to hang out with my friends, talk about their little kids, little hump trophies, like they're important or something, right? Yeah, the kids are just more people. We're overpopulated. Read a science blog. Plus, like, having a kid could be the greatest joy in the known universe, but it's never going to be more fun than playing with the box that it came in, right? That's, you know? But yeah, so I'm not very pro child in my life right now. I'm pro having fun. That's what I am. And like my last girlfriend, she had an IUD. Are you guys familiar with this? It's birth control. I don't know what it is. I just think it's a guy with a space helmet and laser beams, just pew 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 pew, like taking care of business, right? Pew pew pew, sent from the future to protect my future. That's right. That's what that little guy's doing. Thank God for science. That's what I always say. I say that because I'm not that religious. I'm not that religious because as a child, I wasn't taken to church. My oldest memory is my dad would take me, and we would stay long enough for the collection plate to come around, and he would break his change, and we'd go to the strip club down the street. That's what father-son bonding time was like when old Eric over here. And now as an adult, I'm not that religious because there's too much controversy behind it, if you ask me, because I have some friends trying to tell me that Jesus was white, and I have other friends trying to tell me that Jesus was black, and I'm sitting here thinking, you know, that's God's only son? You don't think he might have came in like a special limited edition color or something, you know, like chrome or seafoam green, so you know that that person is special. That's Jesus. He's the Lord's son. He's glitter. He's purple. He's awesome.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks for having me. Magic, thank you for that very committal hand gesture welcoming me to the stage, because nothing is more just awkward and just mind-wracking trying to gather whether a person is a handshaker or they're going to do one of those slap bops, you know what I'm saying? When you go to greet someone for the first time or perhaps meet them and they come in like a middle to low. I get that. That's a business shake. That's two pumps release. Even if they come up like middle high, that's one of those like, what do I got to do to get you in a Ford Focus today? I'm Gil with sales. Yes. But I had a guy throw this up the other day. He went to meet me and he was just like, hey, what in tarnation is that? There's no way that's a handshake. I'm committing to the slap bop. And I got all the way to the point of contact and it was a high handshake. No! And they caught me in the princess hand, you know, and I'm like, oh, hello there. I'm the Duchess of Wales. A pleasure to meet you. And they never want to let go when they get you in the princess hand, you guys. So you either have to chew your arm off like the noble wolf caught in a trap, or they have to escort you to the spring cotillion like a proper lady. And speaking of ladies, you need to have like a commission or just get together and have something where you have a unified handshake, because a lot of ladies legitimately throw the princess hand and I end up crushing a lot of women's hands. Before I know it, my buddy has to shoot me down by the river like I'm Lenny from Of Mice and Men.
Hi, thanks guys. Hello, I'm glad to be here. I'm really glad to be out of the house. I just recently moved back in with my mom because I didn't make a plan ever. So that's been actually pretty cool. It's nice to have a roommate who like cares whether I live or die. That's nice. I'll come home at night and she's sitting there like, oh, you're home, cool. You're home, not sold into prostitution somewhere. Great, awesome, let's celebrate. Come sit down, let's watch this crime investigation show. Celebrate the fact that your body is your own. So that's pretty cool. She's a cool lady. She does have a gun, which I don't really approve of, but I mean, she's a 50-year-old woman who had been living by herself, and she's very wise. If anyone should be allowed to have a gun, she should be allowed to have a gun, which is what I thought until I found out that she has three other guns. And I was like, Mom, why the hell do you have four guns? And she was like, well, this first one didn't fit in my purse, and I needed a purse gun, obviously, you know. And the second one was just the wrong color, you know. And then the third one, you know, has too much kickback and these wobbly arms. I was like, Mom, they're not shoes. Jeez. They're not, you know, scarves. They're not men, you know, something you should have a whole collection of, right? They're weapons. So that's a little about my mom. Don't ever try to break into her house. She'll get you for sure.
Hey, thank you for having me. It was odd growing up with two dads. Yeah, that's right. You're looking at the love child of Emilio Estevez and Barney Rubble. People ask me all the time, like, Brent, you know, how do you keep that physique? Like, how do you rock that dad bod? And I tell them, I've been working out tomorrow for years. I have snacks that I eat on the way to the mailbox. I'll down a bag of chips on the way home from the grocery store. And you know what? If you eat fast food and throw the bag away before you get home, calories don't count. I went to the grocery store the other day, and the bagger says, picks up the fruit basket that I had, or, you know, the bag, and he says, hey, don't forget your bananas. People are weird, man. I was on the plane the other day. This guy sits down next to me. He's clearly uncomfortable, and he's swaying in his seat, and he's going, and I'm trying not to make eye contact because that's not polite. And he looks right at me and goes, hemorrhoids. And my face must have said confusion to him instead of disgust, because the guy started to explain. He was like, yeah, I'm a really hard wiper. Yeah, you know, I strain when I poo. And, you know, if you poo with your mouth open, yeah, you won't strain. I'm on this plane for 2.5 hours. What else am I going to learn? So Granny pipes up next to me, and she's like, oh, I've got two sons. One's a doctor, and one's in prison. I guess one wanted to prescribe drugs, and the other wanted to do drugs. Oh, great. Ding. Flight attendant, Jack and Coke, please. Oh, man. I don't babysit. I don't babysit, and it's not by choice. It's just my neighbors got tired of explaining my recently viewed Netflix options to their kids.